What is Black Ops guerrilla marketing? It's also referred to as content marketing. Well, for me, it's all about, oh, just before I get into that, see this wonderful image by the London graffiti artist, Banksy? You know this guy? Is he Bristol-based? Okay, thank you. Fantastic anonymous graffiti artist. Works of art like this just suddenly pop up in all these random places. We've given him the credit for that, obviously. One of the changes, and I don't know if Ursula, I missed her presentation yesterday, touched on this, but who here in the last few months has been looking for an image for their social media or for a newsletter or for a website or something? They've gone to Google Images, done the search, and then gone right-click download. Who's done that? All of us have done that at some point, I'm sure. You're breaking the law. That is copyright to someone who took that photo. You wouldn't do that with music. You wouldn't do that with video. Very soon you can't do that with images, because the Google bots will suddenly start realizing, because there's meta tags behind all those images online. So little Google bots and other sort of system software will recognize that it's a copyright piece of image. So you've got to have your own original content. That's my point. You've got to stay original. Black Ops guerrilla marketing. Basically, it's about maximizing your content across multiple channels, maximizing the cost benefits, and then creating your own content. And so over the next few minutes, we'll talk about the three P's of content. There's planning, there's producing, and there's publishing. We'll talk about the mothership of content. And finally, we'll talk about those issues of creating audio and video content. This was a big moment. Back at 8:27 p.m. on Saturday, April 23rd, 2005, this happened.
All right, so here we are in front of the elephants. Cool thing about these guys is that they have really, really, really long fronts, and that's cool. And that's pretty much all there is to say.
Okay, that's had 11 million views, by the way. And there's not a cat in sight. Now, his name is Jared Kareem. He was the co-founder of YouTube. Him and his mate went down to San Diego Zoo, shot that, and it only goes for a few seconds. That was the first ever video loaded into YouTube. The world changed on that day. For me, when I took over Tandem Studios, it was back in 2005, and we were sort of doing voiceovers and music and things, then suddenly this thing, podcasting, was all the go. And with my radio background, I went, I no longer need a radio station. And then in April, this thing called YouTube started, and I went, I no longer need a TV station. Blogging was already been around and was starting to grow at that point. Social media, as we know it today, Facebook, etc., hadn't yet started. But the world changed, because suddenly I no longer needed that traditional media to get my message out. I could communicate directly using the internet as my communication channel. And again, I'm not telling you anything that you don't know, because since then, obviously, everything has moved very, very quickly, and we've all been to thousands of seminars on social media, etc. But it meant that you can create your own content and you can get it out. It also means that people use the internet to find what's of relevance to them. And there's some stats. Today, I'm not going to sort of put up a whole bunch of stats, because we can all Google stats, and we've all been to those different sort of conferences where you get them. But it's going to grow, it's going to continue to grow. And one of the big growth areas is on the mobile devices. I noticed everyone was on their mobile phone. Who's got a smartphone or an iPad here? Yep, nearly every single person in the room. David Brain talked about this yesterday as well, which I thought was a fantastic presentation. Why don't you sell advertising? I thought, yeah, okay, that's why don't you? One of the big changes is the live streaming. So if you're putting together a CEO presentation, it might be to the staff around the country, it might be to the shareholders of the company, why not live stream it? You know, it's no big deal to do, it's not a big effort. Not everything has to be a Lord of the Rings production. And that's something, I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about cost, but the traditional video model, et cetera, is, that's got to change like that music industry has changed. Because ease of access and ease, we're filming this too, by the way. We've got one camera there, another camera there. We're recording the audio. So I'm going to use this as my content. So it's pretty simple to do. It still costs a few bucks. So you have to start allowing these into your budgets. Most importantly, convince your clients to do this. Social media is not just Facebook. Facebook is used by a lot of people because it's easy, and we all understand how Facebook works. But there's all these other different social media channels now. So there's all that stuff, right? How do you communicate to everybody through all of those different channels? It's really difficult unless you've got a massive budget. So like anything in marketing, you've got to basically focus on who your target audience is. We found this social media site, actually. My wife and I have just come back from California, and it's called Yelp. And I don't know if you've heard of Yelp, but it's a restaurant and nightclub review social media site. We booked our trip through California using TripAdvisor. So people here have used TripAdvisor as well? I guess it's fantastic. The hotels, the flights, where we were going to go, it was all around this community. So if you're working with anybody in that hospitality area, or in, well, basically hospitality, say for example with TripAdvisor, you've got to start looking after their social media within TripAdvisor. So Facebook, yes, it's important, but Facebook, it's about your friends. So I'm not going to go subscribing to all of these different Facebooks, sort of liking all these different business Facebooks, because I don't want stuff like that coming in when I'm sitting on my couch at home, cruising through my Facebook stuff. Google Plus is a much better business way of connecting to people and sharing information, or LinkedIn is another very good way. But social media is not just Facebook. Multi-purposing content. So we need to think like a publisher. As I talked before about being in radio, the biggest hassle you've got is coming up with 75 new ideas every single week. So how do you multi-purpose? You've got to think visually as well. So when you're putting down your communication plans together, you've got to start thinking, how can I tell the story visually? Where is my audience? Okay, do I need to do a video? Yeah, okay, what type of video? Does it need to be a big elaborate? Does it need to be a simple little thing? To give you an example, here's a case study of Education New Zealand, a client who, as you know, especially in Christchurch, New Zealand generally, we've been trending downwards in getting international students into New Zealand. The international student market is a big focus for Education New Zealand. They want to grow this again. Christchurch post the earthquakes, you know, it was a bad scene. People overseas were Googling Christchurch to find out about schools for the kids, and earthquake stuff was coming up, you know. So there was a big amount of communication had to go that, yeah, Christchurch is still here. Parts of Christchurch are still quite fine, you know. And so that was the story. So as part of helping those international marketers who work within each school, who market out towards the world to bring the students in, Education New Zealand brought Jasara Behrman through to work on educating them about marketing into China. They found out in the first few seminars that not a lot of people were turning up because it was a 6-hour seminar. You know what it's like. You've come here for 2 days. It's a big chunk out of your day. So they said, okay, well, we need to film these. So we sat down and we worked out, okay, you've got this great lady. She's providing all of this wonderful information. How can you multi-purpose that content? So here's just a quick run through that. So first of all, we filmed the seminars.
English marketing materials, then, you know, you're sort of leaving up your imagery to create stories for you. So you'll see a lot of New Zealand companies will put beaches and, you know, empty paddocks with sheep and cows in them. And then, so obviously if these marketing materials in English, they're going to use these pictures as cues to create a story for you. So, oh, there's no people in New Zealand. All they do is lie around on the beach all day. They don't study.
So it was basically a 6-hour seminar. We recorded the whole thing. We inserted the slides in so people could use it. It was more an internal-facing communication. We then edited that into bite-sized chunks. No one's going to sit down. This is another thing to remember. With video today, no one's going to sit down. This may change over time, but at the moment, they're not going to sit down for 6 hours. So you've basically got to provide the information in the format and help guide people to finding what they want. So we chopped those 6 hours of seminars into 15-minute pieces. So we ended up with, 24 videos or something. We titled and tagged each of those segments on key moments, marketing, communication, making friends, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So when someone goes to the website, they don't want to know about that, but they want to know about that bit. So they can watch that bit. So you position the video in such ways that people can find what they want. And then if they want to listen to the other or watch the other, no problems. We also went and had a quick chat with Jasara afterwards. So this was a more sort of in-depth, where I sat down there and I asked her questions that I hoped people wanted answers to in that international marketing school market. So we sat down there and just did a quick 10-minute interview and went a bit like this.
You're living in Shanghai, so how did a Kiwi girl end up in Shanghai?
I first went to China in the Olympic period in 2008, so I spent 3 weeks in Beijing watching all the games and then spent another month travelling from Hong Kong back up to Beijing. Since then I've been back and forth most years. I went over for the Expo in 2010 and last year really decided that it was time to move there and be on the ground. We were doing a lot of work with New Zealand companies exporting to China.
Who's we doing a lot of work?
Sorry, I won't play all the video because I've got to shut up and keep moving along so I don't go over time. So lovely lady, great information. She lives on the ground, so it was really helpful. So that was a 10-minute interview. We did it in a way that it didn't require any editing, so it was really cheap to do. Basically, we sat down with a couple of cameras, we mic'd each other up, and we just went start to finish, and there was no editing involved. We put a top and we put a tail on it, and then bam. So it was pretty cheap to do. That was the second piece of content that we got from the day. The next piece of content, we stripped out the audio and created an audio-only podcast because not everyone wants to watch video.
Jasara, you're in Christchurch for Education New Zealand. You're running a seminar today talking about targeting the education sector in China in particular, aren't you?
So again, that's your third piece of content. You're giving the person the choice of how they want to hear that interview. So they go to that website, the mothership of content that we'll talk about soon, and they go, oh no, I just want to hear the audio, and they can chuck it into their smartphone or their iPod. They can listen to it while they're doing the gardening, walking the dog, whatever it may be. Fourth piece of content. We sent that audio away and we got it transcribed and we created this PDF. So we linked back to the video and the audio within there. And there's the PDF of that whole conversation. So again, if someone wanted to download that and they could grab pieces from that, they could read the whole thing, whatever, you know. So again, you're providing information in the way that best suits that individual at the time. The next bit of content we got from the PDF, we grabbed out all these different quotes that we could then push out through our social media channels. And there's just one of the quotes there. So it's full of quotes. So it meant that it was really easy for you, the communicator, to just go through and go, there's a quote, there's a quote, there's a quote, and then you can roll that out over the following months. The next piece of content, photos. It's a visual world. So all of these photos we grabbed from the video. And these photos, one thing to remember with the photos is you can't publish this in print form, but the resolution is fantastic for online. So for using a digital newsletter or for pushing it out through social media or for a website, photos from videos are fine. If you're publishing as well, if you want to go into print form, you need a photographer there, a man who's been doing a huge job here over the last couple of days, was out last night here early again this morning. You need a good camera with a high resolution that can be printed in. So basically, just to recap, we got the social media grabs, there was the transcript of the audio, there was the audio podcast, there was the video interview, the seminar filming, all just from one session. So we did that through good planning. We thought about it before we went along and we decided we wanted all these different bits of content and we went in there with a goal in mind. You could also use those content for press releases, for your newsletters that may go out, whether they're digital newsletters or whether they're print newsletters, whatever. And if you are sending out newsletters, you link back to watch our video of Jasara, download the audio. Here's the PDF, here's the social media grabs, whatever it may be. So really it's about 8 pieces of content that we captured on the one day. And then there was a little bit of editing and mucking around to get it all together, but generally it's not too far. My guys here, this is Sean, by the way, and Emma, part of the team. These guys are really good, and Nick as well, you know. These guys, they know this stuff. I've got an idea of sort of how to, I go to them with an idea and I say, guys, I've had this idea. I promised the client we're gonna do this. And they just sort of roll their eyes and, you know, and they find out a way to do it. I'm very lucky in that. Okay, the first of our three P's. We talked about planning, producing, production. So planning for me is the key stage. Talked before when we went to Disneyland and we went to Anaheim. Who's been to Disneyland, by the way? How awesome is Disneyland? Fantastic. I just loved it. Loved everything about it. And I bought this autobiography on Walt Disney. And he was an inspirational man, just this visionary. And one of the things, I mean, he did so many different things, but one thing that struck me was when he was doing any of his cartoons or movies, he would spend all this time in the planning stage to the point that apparently he was just, you know, a bit of a bastard. Because he would work on the story. They'd bring him the story and the pre-production notes and all the outlines, and then he'd look at it and they would go back and work on it again. They'd bring it back and then they'd go back. So he would really work on that planning stage. So by the time they moved into production, it was pretty much a straightforward, on time, on budget sort of shoot. And then when they went to the final sort of stage, they knew that this was going to work. They knew that it was going to connect with the audience. So planning is where you save your money in online production. It's by thinking about what you want to do. Key things like, who is your audience? Know your audience. And that's a question sometimes that we forget. You don't have to do the Lord of the Rings production. It can be just one of those simple seminar videos, which is okay, but it's a great educational tool. Who's your audience? You create that content plan. So when you're creating the content plan, you've got to think that, who's my audience? Where are they? What do they want to know? And they're sort of some of those key basic questions you ask. Another thing, I talk about the online audience. They're not page views, they're not clicks, they're not likes, they're an audience. We all use the web today as part of our lives. We use it to laugh with those crazy cat videos, we use it to cry, we use it to share, we use it to work. You know, it's part of our lives and it will become more and more so as time goes by. So it's an online audience, you're talking to people. And yesterday Roger Sutton, when we were doing one of the interviews after his address, he said one of the key things to remember in communications is to listen. And you know, I thought that was a really good point. So know your audience, and then you provide that information. So what are some of the key points coming up in when you're planning, you're sitting down there doing your communication plans, what are some of those key events? What are some of the, are there birthdays coming up? Is there product launch going out? So you sit down, I would say once every 3 months or so, much like I did in radio, that's how I manage those 75 ideas a week, as I would sit down and then come up with a whole bunch of stuff. And then you can sort of slot that into your calendar, and then you can, we'll talk about the production in just a moment, then you can produce it in a chunk, and then you can roll it out over the course of the following 3 months. So the planning is a biggie. Coordinating with your teams, your marketing team, with your management team is also terribly important. You'll know that, and that was touched on several times yesterday. And also part of the planning is be consistent with your publishing. I don't know if anyone sort of launched a Facebook site for a client. You go hell for leather, and then other things sort of get in the way, and suddenly you stop sort of posting and updating, and you lose all your friends that you've made there. Same with if you're publishing regular video content, is that consistency. We all know what time our favourite TV show is on every week. It's on a Tuesday at 7:30. We know that, it's that consistency. It becomes part of our habit. One of my favourite podcasts is Media Watch. I know that Media Watch is going to be online every day by Monday, midday, sorry, every Monday by midday. So I can download it Monday afternoon, and if I'm walking Monday night, I know that I've got Media Watch to listen to. It becomes part of my habit. So that's where the consistency is terribly important. So once you've got your plan, producing. So you've worked out who your audience is, what type of message it is that you want to get to them, and the best channel that you might be using to get to them. So producing it. How do you sort of get your bang for your buck is a key question. How do you cut those costs? Well, here's a company, Christchurch company, fabulous business called SLI Systems. SLI-systems.com, I think is their website offhand. But they're great online. If you Google them, you'll find them. We do a lot of video blogs for these guys. So the way that we keep their production costs down is we work with Sean, their CEO. He does these video blogs. He'll sit there basically at his laptop, and we'll screen capture what's going on his laptop, and then we'll have a camera and a microphone on him as well. So it's a really simple little production piece. He comes in, and he's going to do four in the one session. So because he's reasonably practiced now, he can knock them out in 2 hours. So his filming cost, et cetera, with us is 2 hours. We then edit them because there's minimal editing involved because he's practiced before he's come in. So again, there's another few hours in the editing. And so at the end of all of that, and then we format it in the correct formats and we send it to him, et cetera. So, you know, there's what, 5-6 hours work or something in it. Am I right with that, Sean? Sean hates it when I sort of underquote on things. So basically, he's got his 4 video blogs, and I won't go into sort of details because he's a client, but it doesn't cost him a lot of money because you've planned it well, and then with your production, you've thought about, okay, how can we maximise our production time? And so when it comes to sort of publishing, he's got this video, and it's only cost him a few hundred bucks kind of thing per. So I thought also one thing that SLI do is they take their content and they repurpose it across multiple channels. So SLI are an internal site search company. So if you go to Dick Smith and you search on the Dick Smith website, numerous other websites as well, it's their software that searches internally and it finds social media comments through the Dick Smith site as well as all their products. So that's SLI Systems. They're about to launch on the stock exchange in the next few weeks. Great company. They give information away. They want to be thought leaders. So they do webinars, they do live streaming events, they do ebooks, they do electronic newsletters, they do podcasts, they do video blogs, they turn up and do seminars where they'll play a lot of this information that they've gathered. So that's what I mean by multiple channels. So they will use this content across all those different multiple channels. They do blogs, of course, they do social media, you know, they do a lot. So here's a look at the front page of their website. So we'll sort of scroll down there. Don't know if you can see that very clearly. We'll click on the video blogs. So there's all the video tips they've got. And this is one of those video blogs we've talked about.
Hi, I'm Sean Ryan from SLI Systems, and this is the Site Search Video Tips. Today, I'm going to talk about too many results. So here at Hot Topic, I've done a search for hoodies. And they've got 205 results for hoodies. They're showing 16 results per page, and they've got a couple.
So Sean goes on to say, you know, sort of how to cut down those search results so you're not having to look at sort of all those pages, etc. All of those video blogs are on YouTube and other websites, other video hosting systems within their own website. Really nice, and they last for years. We've been working with them now for 3 or 4 years. So a lot of those video tips are still relevant now. So you get great value for money by maximising the length of time you can use that video. So why do they get into new media so much? Not a lot of New Zealand companies do this. We caught up with the marketing director and co-founder of SLI, a guy called Jeff Brash, and had this quick chat with him.
I mean, we got into the new media marketing because we're already doing email marketing, we're doing other things like that. So I think it's really an obvious draw card for a technology company like ours to get into new media with our podcast, e-commerce podcast, and our site search video tips. So getting into that new media just seemed obvious, I think, for a technology company like ours. Actually, the biggest surprise is how much work there's actually involved. I mean, I think that you watch other people doing podcasts, you listen to them, you watch video online, you think this is so easy. And technology has made it a lot easier. But I think it's just the commitment and time to coordinate people to interview, to just find the time yourself, I think really was the big surprise for us. Yeah, the way we plan our new media initiatives, I think, is around our customers and people we interview. So whether we've got a case study or a customer trying something new out, if we can find a topic they're casual, relaxed about, it's much easier to get them engaged, whether it's with an audio recording or with a video recording. It's very cost effective. I think that's one of the things that we knew from the start was that we're looking at other traditional advertising and magazines and other things like that, and compared to that, most new media is very, very cost effective. I think another side of it is just the commitment you need to have to make sure you produce good content is where you put the effort in. Yeah, I think one of the big learning things for us is how we've been doing it for a number of years and how few people are actually following with what we're doing. We did it a lot because we're a tech company, because we thought it was obvious. We thought that for us it was a good way to be a thought leader. We've been doing that in other ways, like with speaking in conferences and doing other content. And In America, where we operate, most of our customers are American. It's much more common for people to try and do new media initiatives. But in New Zealand, we've actually been surprised that more people aren't also doing similar things. So it's quite a surprise for us. We're definitely looking at continuing what we're doing with new media and seeing where we can expand that into the future. So as long as we've got willing participants and we've got time ourselves and we see the returns, we'll continue to do it.
As I say, they'll be doing their stock listing in the next few weeks, and I hope that it's really successful. They're a very smart company. They've been growing. And their market, by the way, their key markets are in America and through Europe. So that's also one of the big reasons they use new media as part of their marketing, is because for them to advertise to their markets, if they were using the conventional methods, would be incredibly expensive. So they've put this effort into that online marketing. All right, one thing to remember too, and these guys also were a good example of that, is the digital long tail of content, or the one versus many. Many clients have come to us over the years and said, we want to make a viral video. And it's like, bring in the cat. Because it's really difficult to plan a viral video. You know, lots of people try and some might have success, but I would imagine more fail than successful. The digital long tail was an article that was a groundbreaking article, and for me it was just like, oh yeah, got that. A guy called Chris Anderson, who was the editor of Wired magazine, I think it was, wrote this article about the digital long tail. So if you've got a lot of content, and we've talked about it a couple of times already this morning, you put enough content out there and then you choose what you want, you choose what you want, you choose what you want, you choose what you want. Each of those videos might get 100 views, it might get 10 views, it might get 15, it might get 1,000 views. Something may go viral. Collectively, that adds up to your contact points, your communication points. An SLI with that consistent production of their content is a good example of the digital long tail. Some of those videos may have had thousands of views, I don't know. Some may have only had 100, but they are providing that consistent content, leaving the online audience to choose. To give you another example, here's a whole bunch of websites that use as part of their business plan the digital long tail. And they are very big sites. Amazon has got millions of books to choose. So they don't have to sell a million copies like a bookstore to make a big buck. They can sell 10 of them, 10 of them. Same with eBay. Same with iTunes with the music. They've got all of this music available and they sort of clip the ticket on the way through, and same with Trade Me. That is an example of the digital long tail. You put enough content up there and you create the touch points. Let's talk about the publishing, the third P. Publishing's the trickiest part. It's easy enough to sort of create content. You can plan it, you can sort of get your iPhone, you can produce your content, no problems. The publishing is difficult. You don't have to rely on the traditional media, as I said, but you've got to make sure that if you're producing all of that content on a regular basis, that it can be found. I mean, you as a great communications manager may be managing the system beautifully, fantastic, and then you leave, and some other poor person comes in and they go, oh my God, where is everything? You've got your new staff arriving that you might want to show them videos that you did 2-3 years ago, an internal training video, whatever it may be, an occupational health and safety video. Material can be used for a long time, so it's got to be found. So I sort of like that term, the mothership of content. You use a lot of these external hosting systems of YouTube, of Flickr for hosting your photos, of podcast sites for hosting audio, et cetera, et cetera. But you've got to sort of basically track that. So as years go by, and this is going to be one of the issues because we are producing more and more content, you are producing more and more content, is managing that content over time. I mean, we all know what it's like with our digital Word doc files. You know, you end up with a lot of that stuff. So once you start adding audio, video, and photos to that whole mix, your management of it is a key thing going forward. So I like to create what I call the motherships. And one of them is this example here of a website we run for Parliament. It's now got 17,000 videos in it. It's called In the House. Collectively, that digital long tail has got something like 3 million views. So all of the videos hosted on YouTube, but it can be found at this particular website. And one video links to another. It's easy to search. If anybody wants to find any information from, I think we've been doing it for 4 years now, you can find the information from 4 years ago. And all of the video is there, and it's nice and easy to find and play and share. You find a video, you can share it out through the social media. Another thing with, I thought I'd play this to you because Parliament's pretty dry, right? But collectively that long tail, as I said, it's got up to 3 million views. One of the reasons was this particular video here.
Sir, I want to first of all congratulate and wish you all for this bill.
Go figure.
And I want to say, sir, that the good news about the years in this Parliament is you learn to deflect all of the dreadful...
Who's seen this video, by the way?
..sort of fire and brimstone accusations that are going to happen, sir. I've had a reverend in my local electorate call, the gay onslaught will start...
It was a great speech. Great speech. I don't need to play it to you again. There was another video in there where the bill was finally passed and there was a spontaneous singing of Pokari Kariana. That has also got something like 1.3 million views. So things can go viral, but, you know, we didn't plan for that to happen. It just kind of went. Different styles of content that... how are we going for time? Yeah, okay, I'm still in. Different styles of content. We can record lots of stuff on iPhone through to studio level. The quality of production is reflective of your brand. But it's also about the story. So, again, through that planning, who are you talking to, what do you want to say, and where is the audience? That then dictates the style of content. So, one style of content that I've broken it down into three things. There's self, there's info, and then there's brand. You can break it down. David Brain yesterday said within his Edelman company they've got six styles of content they use. I've broken it down to three because I'm pretty simplistic like that. The self-generated content. One of the advantages of this is that it can be quick and it can be fast. Civil defence during the earthquake, when their guys were first going out onto the scene, they grabbed their iPhones and they could take video and they could send it back to head office, and they very quickly, visually, thank God there was still Vodafone and Telecom working, they very quickly could ascertain what was happening on the scene. That was good self-generated content. Lots of people posted their own video from their own earthquake experience up. A couple of issues about that is you have to be careful when you're planning that, don't shoot too much. Again, if people are watching it over their mobile phones, it's expensive to use. If you shoot heaps of stuff, then you've got to send it to someone like Sean to edit it down so it's a nice 30-second, 60-second piece. So before you start shooting, have a think about, okay, what's happening? How am I going to start this? How am I going to finish this? Will I talk about it as well? If you're shooting yourself as well, audio is another problem. Our ears are amazing. Our ears can tune to me, can tune to our next door neighbour, can tune to something back there, and then something catches us, we sort of really focus in on that. Our ears can do that. Microphones cannot do that. Microphones are tricky. So if you're listening to someone and you're shooting on a little video camera or an iPhone, you might be hearing it fantastically, but there might be wind noise going around. There might be trucks going in the background, and that's what the microphone's picking up. So audio is always a bit of an issue with self-generated content. So here's something. This is a little bit harrowing, so I'll only play a little bit of it, but it was very powerful. This was from the Oklahoma tornado that swept through. I don't know if you've seen this on TV. It was where one of the teachers was in the classroom with all the kids, locked in a little sort of dark room, and then she went out and saw that the school had been destroyed.
Calm down! Listen! Listen!
Oh my God, listen. Please welcome.
Okay. Wow. Oh my God. Oh my God. Oh my God, my house. Oh my God. Oh my God.
So as I said, it's harrowing, but it was very, very powerful, and that was just done on a dodgy little phone. So the quality of that production didn't matter. The impact was very powerful. The second style of content I like to refer to is the info. This could be training videos, it could be putting together your own digital media pack, which you've done probably hundreds of times, but now you've got to start thinking about what else do you need to supply to the media. Press, it's going to be more and more difficult as time goes by to get media to your events because, as we know, traditional media are cutting back. Also, another issue is that with paywalls coming up, which I'm sure they will do with the Herald and the Stuff website, that's going to drop their visitor numbers. So you might be providing nice content to those websites, but it might be behind a paywall. And so, and this refers back to the mothership of content, so if it's behind the paywall, people Googling might not be able to get to it. They might see it come up in the Google results, but they'll click on it and it goes, you know, must subscribe. And I think that will drop the numbers to those websites. So that's why you need to have your own mothership of content so people can still find your stuff online. Don't rely on the publishers. The info style, create your own media pack, make sure it's sitting somewhere. You send out all of the links to your different media or stakeholders, internal, external, and then you link them back to the video, to the photos, to the audio, to the transcript, to whatever it may be. Here's an example of what we did for the Canterbury Community Trust. They were launching something. We went down there and filmed the Alec Neil. So we made the video available for people.
And so on behalf of my fellow trustees who are here with us today...
So I'll sort of flick through this. We also created something called time-lapse. Time-lapse photos are really popular for people to view. We did all of the social media content for Ellerslie. We've done this for the last few years. But we found that time-lapse photos that we did of the Ellerslie event were the most popular. And we did 50 videos in the last year for them, hundreds of different photos and things. Time-lapse photos really work. They look good. We also created these photos from the video, again, for publishing online only. If you wanted sort of to create good print photos, as you know, you've got to get a photographer out there. And we also made the audio available. So there was the video, the time-lapse, the photos, the transcripts, and the audio. So that's your digital media pack, repurposing the content. The third style of content you might go for is your brand content, where there's a bigger budget, you'll throw some more money at it, and then you can use this content as sort of part of your sort of marketing branding, if you like. So here's something that we did for an Ashburton property company. Got to go up in a helicopter. The doors were off. We're hanging out, well, I wasn't, but Nick was hanging out the doors, strapped in with a camera like this, doing all the video footage from the helicopter. It was fun. So one way to sort of multi-purpose that content is it can go into your website. You can put it into DVDs. You can use it in giant screens because you're shooting it really nicely, HD. It's a really good quality production. You've got a script, so you're telling a longer sort of form of the story to it. You can use it in any presentations that they might be using for a client. So that's more your sort of branding quality, if you like. Okay, nearly there. To summarise, your planning. Sit down once every few months, work out what's coming up. And within that, what sort of budget have you got to work with? Because then that dictates your production later on. Who's that audience? How can you repurpose one thing that you're doing across a lot of different channels? What style of content? Is it the self? Is it the info? Is it the brand? Who's going to produce it? A lot of you can produce. I met Sean last night. Met a lot of lovely people last night. And Tom. Is Tom here as well? He won himself a prize. Maybe he kicked on a bit last night and didn't sort of make it this morning. I don't know. But Sean was talking about making a client with no budget wanted a video. Bloody clients with no budget. But he was into it. So you can make a lot of content yourself, no problems. And that's why we've introduced tandem learning. Okay, there's issues about audio, there's issues about editing, there's issues about formatting. The video I've played here has to be in a particular format. Formatting drives me crazy. Sean sort of, and the guys in the production team, they understand the formatting. DVD's a different format, online video's a format, PowerPoint's a different bloody formats. So who's going to produce it is another key question. And then who will own the content? If a company's traditionally that, like the music industry earlier, video production companies have to change. Traditionally, if you go out and shoot the video, and the video company will go, there you go, and the rest of the footage belongs to us. And we're going to sell it online as little clips and all that sort of stuff. Whatever, you know. If you're paying me to go out and shoot for a couple of hours, it's your footage. I don't mind, you know. I'm going out there to capture it. So who owns the content? Sometimes, yes, you might get that content, but then, as I said earlier, there's the management of that content. Do you want to end up with a hard drive full of all gigabytes and gigabytes and gigabytes of raw footage? So that's, you know, one of the things that you'll have to work out. Summarising the producing. Once you've got your plan, stick to it, because that cuts down the cost later. And it can make sure you stay on budget. Stick to that time frame, but be prepared to ad lib. You might turn up somewhere and something really cool is happening. So you're crazy cat jumping. Get that. You see someone smiling. Whenever I'm making any content, I like to really try and connect with the online audience in some way. And generally, that is some emotional connection. And that's a really powerful, powerful way to communicate. So if you're seeing someone smiling and having a lovely time or just laughing, whatever, boom, get that. Even if it's not in your script, get it. And keep in mind when you're producing, where is it going to be published and how you're going to use it. Don't overcreate because that creates cost. If you come in with hours of footage that you've shot and you want to chop it down to 2 minutes, well, okay, no problems, it can be done, sure. But it takes a lot longer to chop it back down. And then, so that blows, it can potentially blow out your budget. Also, try not to get the edit around too many people. One of the issues that we have, and you've probably worked on this in other projects, if you've got a particular video that you're doing and you send it out to the committee and the manager sees it and the manager secretary sees it and this person, and they've all got the comment and it all comes back and you go, again, yeah, sure, we can change it, but you know, it's going to cost a little bit more than we first quoted, sort of thing. So try and, once through good planning, stick to that vision, and that, again, looks after the budget. Publishing, the right format for all those different media channels. You got to back up. As soon as we get this footage here, we'll be backing up. And we buy a hard drive for every particular project. We may then give that to you. Oh, we just sort of archive it ourselves, but you got to back up. So content, as much as it can last, it can also date, but you can re-edit it. So some of that content, like the Oklahoma thing, you know, that'll sort of fade off in views over a little while, but you could come back to that and re-edit and go, remember 1 year ago, this happened. You know, so again, you repurpose, it's back to that radio ideas thing 73 times. I didn't come up with 73 new ideas. Sometimes I took an idea that I used there, repurposed it slightly, and I could reuse it again later. So the same with your content. Make sure it can be found. Again, create that mothership of content, or newsroom.com. Jackie was telling me, Jackie's helped me put this together by Jackie Woods, which is, thank you very much, Jackie. Was telling me about newsroom.com, where you can upload all of your digital media packs, if you like, and then it can sit there. We create blog sites for a lot of people that are about $1,000, even less, sometimes a little bit more. It doesn't cost a lot to make a website these days. Don't overpublish. Nothing worse than being bombarded with Facebook updates all the time, all the time, all the time. But make sure you are consistent in time when you publish and in the style. And share that out with all the media and different blogs, which you do as well. Number one rule is don't be boring. Don't be boring. A good friend of mine tells me the story of they made this video, and it was a bit rubbishy. Someone reacted to it really badly and said, I've just wasted 2 minutes of my life watching your video. It's like, oh my God. So people, if they're giving you their time, don't be boring. And connect, engage, inform. Be fresh, be original. Create your own original content. And I'm at 45 minutes and I've hit my mark. Boom.